On today's show, the unpredictable, uninhibited comedian Todd Glass. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. On today's show, Todd Glass. You've seen him on Kimmel, Conan, Seth, Jimmy Fallon, Comedy Central. Just a terrific comedian, an absolute original, and one of the first people ever to do a podcast. And you can listen to The Todd Glass Show on iTunes. I highly recommend it. He also has a book out, published by Simon and Schuster, called The Todd Glass Situation, A Bunch of Lies About My Personal Life and a Bunch of True Stories About My 30-Year Career in Stand-Up Comedy. Again, it's published by Simon and Schuster. Why not go to davidfeldmanshow.com and buy it on Amazon via our website? We'll get a small percentage of that. I want to welcome some new members to Team Feldo: Tom Chapman, Russell Martucci, Mark Rossback, Kevin Kosterer, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, and Derek Boland. You too can join Team Feldo. By the way, thank you guys for joining Team Feldo. You too can join Team Feldo by becoming a subscriber, $5 a month. You can gain access to all our premium content. This week we have two old episodes featuring Eddie Pepitone and Frank Conniff. They're written by me and Steve Rosenfield. They're funny little sketches from Pepitone Tonight. We had that fake talk show that Eddie Pepitone hosted with Frank as his sidekick. We're locking up the vault. 1,000 episodes dating back to 2009. We've got to take them down off the server. It's just too expensive. But we're going to be releasing new premium episodes from the vault. And you can have access to that for $5 a month. We're going to start releasing new premium content and then older episodes. It's definitely worth $5 a month, and you'll be supporting the show. It costs money to produce this show. What else? Yeah, you know, I always talk about Amazon. We get a small percentage if you shop on Amazon via the David Feldman Show website. It adds up, and we would like you to become a subscriber. SmileTrain.org. A lot of my listeners asked me how to contact SmileTrain. They heard the Jimmy Pardo show last week. That's Jimmy's charity. So if you enjoyed last week's conversation with Jimmy Pardo, throw a little cash over at SmileTrain. SmileTrain.org. And not for nothing, I keep getting emails from my listeners telling me how much they enjoyed the Judy Gold episode. So that's still available for download. I highly recommend the Judy Gold episode. All our episodes. Hey, this is exciting, and it won't cost you any money. We're doing a live taping of the David Feldman Show, November 10th, 2014. 2014, 2015. We're doing a live taping of the David Feldman Show, November 10th, 2015, at 7 p.m. at QED in Astoria with Jackie the Joke Man Martling, Frank Conniff, who you all know, and Esther Koo. She's an hysterical comedian who starred on the Jack and Triumph Show on Adult Swim this year. We're giving away free tickets to all our listeners. I'm giving away free tickets to my listeners to see a live taping of the David Feldman Show, starring Jackie the Joke Man Martling, Frank Conniff, Esther Koo. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Hit the contact button. By the way, it's working. Our contact button was down. I don't know why, but now it's working. So you can contact me and I'll get back to you. If you would like to see a live taping of the David Feldman Show, November 10th, 2015, at 7 p.m., at QED in Astoria, Queens, with Jackie the Joke Man Martling, Esther Koo, and Frank Conniff, go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the contact button, and say, please put me on the guest list for your live taping. It's just that easy. Make sure you give us your email address so we can get back to you and confirm the dates. If you don't live in Astoria, Queens, and you know somebody who does, tell them about it. And contact me via the contact button, and we'll put those people on the list. We're going to start doing more and more live tapings of this show. We used to do it. We used to do live tapings a couple of years back at the Fake Gallery in Los Angeles. We're going to start doing them again. And my listeners can attend these tapings for free November 10th, 2015 at QED. We're going to do a live taping in Boston, one in Washington, D.C. We're going to do one in Ithaca, New York. We're going to do one in Los Angeles. We're planning a lot of live tapings of this show with special guests. So come out, please. I want to meet you. There were a couple of listeners who came to see me perform at QED 2 weeks ago. I don't know their names. I forgot their names, but thank you for coming, and we had a nice conversation, and I gave, they all had PhDs, which was kind of interesting, in nanotechnology. No, the two of them had PhDs. One of them only had a master's, only. And I gave them some free downloads, which we'll probably do at the November 10th show at QED. We'll probably give out some free downloads of premium content if you come out and support us. Okay. Todd Glass via FaceTime. Not Skype, not on phone, via FaceTime. Let me know what you think. I think the sound quality is okay. This is a fun one. Todd Glass.
Todd Glass is the host of Never Not Funny. His podcast-a-thon raises money for the Smile Train, which is a great cause. Everybody should give it to. It is a good cause. You know, you joke about that, and he's just a quick wit, and he's I love him. Never Not Funny.
Hey, David.
Yes?
Can I tell you something? And I'm no disrespect. I think you have the. This is Todd Glass.
I know.
Yeah, that's I.
Okay.
And that's the end of that bit. Boom, boom.
Todd Glass is, well, I wouldn't be doing a podcast if it weren't for Todd Glass. And I say that just to piss off Jimmy Dore.
Thank you.
Because I used to do your podcast with Jimmy, comedy and everything else, back in 2009. And I thought, what the hell are you doing? This is like playtime.
Yeah, it does. Do you edit it a little? Like this part here, will you edit this out?
Oh, no, this is gold.
Oh, that's what I thought, but I didn't want to say anything.
Are you there?
How about some goddamn laughs? How about some goddamn laughs?
Are you there?
Yeah, I am here.
You're not breaking up. I just feel you're not present.
Oh, I'm present, all right. I'm so present. I'm sitting here with a hard on and a bucket of tuna fish. So. Which was coincidentally the name of my first country album, but that's an all another story. I got a lot of trouble back then. Well, those were different times.
Yeah, country's an interesting interesting word, isn't it? Because you know the word country. Because it's
yeah. What about it?
Well, it's two syllables. Together, they're fine, but when you break them up, it's offensive. Like tree. The word
that's
tree.
True.
Tree is very offensive to me because it evokes dog urine.
What do you want to ask me? Let's get to the meat of this interview.
Well, what I'm saying,
by the way, I only have 3 hours. So.
Okay, I'm just making an observation about life because I'm changing my act.
Thank you for the background laughing at my joke. It's the guy who tries to act like he's in a hurry, but. To have the upper hand, but the truth is he has nothing to do. I got 3 hours and then I gotta go.
So the word country is kind of funny because it's like together those two syllables work, but separately the word tree is offensive. Kind of like, you know what? Like,
you know, but,
hang on. Madam Secretary, right? I can call Hillary Madam Secretary, but if I call her a madam or a secretary, I'm George Carlin.
Yeah, what do you want me to say here?
I want you to say, David, that's so funny.
Well, I love you too much to throw you in the wrong direction.
All right. Where are you performing?
I mean, it's cute. It's cute. Do you like cute?
I like
cute. No, I'm serious. It's adorable. If you were my son and you were doing jokes, I'd say, God damn it, I think you got something.
Todd Glass.
And by the way, I'm not lying. Like, I think you're the funniest person in the world. I do think you're very, very funny. Not the funniest in the world.
No, James Adomian is the funniest person in the world.
Well, Eddie Pepitone, James Adomian. But no, I do think you're very funny, and I love hanging out with you. So I'm not trying to be like, if something's funny, I'll laugh. But I thought you were doing that sarcastically, to be honest. Like, oh,
I was.
Like, you know,
Of course I was.
Because you know what one time you got me, David? When it was like 4 years into cell phones, or five, or whatever it was. It was way past. Everybody had a cell phone when you did this. It might have been 10 years ago. And you looked at me when I pulled my cell phone. And I go, oh, excuse me. And I was like, what? And you go, I'm kidding. I go, oh, Jesus. I was like, how far behind is this guy?
I still do that.
But you were doing a bit.
Yeah, I still do that.
You were doing a bit. It's, by the way, it gets funnier the more the years roll around. Somebody pulls out a cell phone. Whoa, someone's having a good year.
Is that Hollywood calling?
No.
I do that now if I'm with people. I'm not trying to be a jerk. But I have to. This is my cell phone. I know. But I do have to take this call.
Oh yeah. By the way, I do it too, and I never give you credit. And one time, somebody said, "Doesn't David Feldman do that?" And I punched him in the dick. And it was Sarah Silverman. So,
hey, I send jokes out, and I like to give jokes away. And I gave this joke. SNL didn't do this joke. Tracy Morgan was on this week.
And, which I loved.
Right. And they didn't do this joke. I thought this would have been funny because the week before they had Amy Schumer, right?
Mm-hmm.
So last week we had the star of Trainwreck. And this week we have the star of Carwreck.
Carwreck?
Yeah. You would think he would have done that joke, right?
Yeah.
No, seriously, wouldn't that have been?
No, that is a funny joke. Maybe, how do you know they got it?
You mean not get the joke?
Yeah, how do you know they got the joke, like received it? Where do you send these jokes?
Oh, I don't know. But, and then, how's Sarah?
I can't talk about it. No, I'm on a legal binder. Something happened.
Okay.
Can I tell you the truth? Yeah. I slept at her house because I was too, you know, I'd been drinking a little. I want to drive home. And I woke up and she had her hand down my pants.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's all I'm allowed to say. That's all I'm allowed to say because of her lawyers and my lawyers and everything. It's a fucking mess. And I hate it.
It's weird sleeping over at Sarah's and saying because I can't drive home because she has a mobile home. So she could have just driven you home.
Well, that is true, too.
But is that cute?
No, that's adorable. I don't want my bit to be that I'm making fun of you because that's not what I do. So let's.
You don't make.
I don't want it to be like, oh, I'm. You know me. I don't like when people come on my podcast and want to roast me. So I don't want to roast you. Okay. I don't like being roasted.
By the way, I've never done your podcast. I did it with a guest host.
Oh right, you did it with Daniel Kino. I'm the only podcast, by the way, secure enough. You know when. When Johnny Carson used to take vacations, he'd have guest hosts. Leno never did it, and no podcast never do it. Sometimes when I can't do my podcast, someone fills in for me. And you know what? Because I'm not scared. You know why they're not going to do? They're not going to do a good job like me because you know how? I tell Aristotle to make sure of it.
Aristotle?
He's the producer of the show.
Is that really his name?
I know it is his name. It's a great name, and I love having him on my show because Aristotle. And he has a dog, and his name is, David. And his name is Aristotle. You got to love it. This is not interesting. I feel like this is so boring.
I had guest hosts on my show.
What if my niece and nephew find this podcast in 30 years, and they go, hey, what was your Uncle Todd like? And they go, oh, let's play this podcast.
Yeah.
And not because of you, because of me. I just want to get to some good
We will.
Needy. What do you want to ask me?
Well,
I'm so ready.
Okay. First of all, we asked.
Take your time. It's your show. Don't let me lead.
Okay. We asked our Twitter and Facebook followers and people who go to my website to ask questions for Todd Glass, because you solve people's problems.
Thank you.
We do. So we have about 10 questions. And before we get to them, I want to plug your podcast and where you're going to be performing next.
Oh, well, I my podcast is The Todd Glass Show. People might have seen me on Tosh.0, The Daily Show, Louie. I tour with people like Sarah Silverman, Daniel Tosh, David Cross, Louis C.K. And when I'm not touring with other people, I do my own club dates where I headline around the country. Matter of fact, I'm going to be soon coming up to the D.C. Improv Halloween weekend. I'll be at the Washington, D.C. Improv getting ready for my Netflix special that I'll be shooting in December. Then I'm off with some Jim Gaffigan. I'll be doing all Jim Gaffigan dates in Boston. Then I'll go to D.C. and do that date we just talked about. And then I'll meet up with Jim Gaffigan again in Minneapolis and do all his Minneapolis dates. Check me out. I'll be at the Austin Velveeta Room the 20th and 21st of November. It's always a lot of fun, and that's a great room with a good energy and just a great vibe in that room. And that's it for now. And then I will be, the day after Christmas, I'll be at the Comedy Cabaret in beautiful Bucks County. Two shows, the 26th of December.
Bucks County, is that in Pennsylvania?
Yes.
Wow. And the Velveeta Room, is that where Kinison and Hicks started?
Yep.
How big is that room?
That room holds about 100 people. I'll be doing 5 shows, so don't get any ideas.
Okay. Our first question for Todd Glass comes from Howard Greenberg, who listens to us in New Jersey. Hi, Howie. He says, my girlfriend can never admit she's wrong. Is that a trait that women solely possess? That's a good question.
First of all, let me stop and say this. I do honestly try to figure out help people with what I call tangible advice, like not the type of advice that you can't implement right away, like a clean, do I do it all the time? No, but I try to. And it's not because I think I'm perfect. I have my problems, but I go to other people that I trust. And to get feedback from your friends that's honest, every friend, if you're hanging around a good group of people, will give you honest feedback. But the more you turn it down, not every time, sometimes someone gives you feedback and you don't like it. But if 100% of the time people come to you and go, you know what, Todd, your friend was right, or you were wrong here, and you put it off and you deny it every time, they're going to stop giving you feedback. So the way to get honest feedback is when you get it, accept it. Because if you don't, they'll stop giving it, and then you'll get friends. Everyone has their own problems. So if you're going to fight correction, people aren't going to give it to you. They're going to come to you. They're going to say it, and then you're going to go, yeah, but blah, 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 blah.
But do people sometimes criticize you because they want to hurt you?
Because they want to what?
Hurt you.
No.
In other words, has anybody ever given you constructive criticism, and after a while you realize, you know what, this person is just effing with me?
No.
Never. You don't think people do that?
Well, I'm sure everything happens, but if my friends do that at my age, I think it's saying more about me, and that's the people I surround myself with.
Do you think it's possible hang on for one second. Do you think it's possible that somebody can be criticizing you, and at one point you have to finally say, you know what, I just don't think you like me?
Yeah, or couldn't you just slowly move away without having that conversation?
If somebody criticizes you every day, if they have one criticism for you every day, and they're either your girlfriend, your wife, your boyfriend, your friend, they always have a criticism for you. Is that a problem? I'm adding on to this question, by the way. Sorry.
Yeah, we'll go back to your question in New Jersey. I'm trying to answer this simply. Yeah, that could happen, but why would you... You know what? Here's what I say. I take criticism from people that love me. So, yeah, if somebody, I don't know, criticism, it sounds like such a hard word. Sometimes just going, oh, don't do that. Or, yeah, you know what? Let that go. Like, no, I don't think if people constantly are giving you advice or advice doesn't have to be you sit someone down for 3 hours. Advice can be like, you know what? I'm going to tweet back at that person and tell them blah, blah, blah. And you have a friend go, Todd, don't tweet back. Just don't. Little things like that, no, that's called honest friendships. As long as there's equal amount of love and admiration, I don't care. So let's go back to that person.
Okay,
is
this a trait? My girlfriend can never. The question is, my girlfriend can never admit she's wrong. Is this a trait that women solely possess? So he's asking, because this is a cliche that women have a problem?
First of all, I don't think so. And I can answer that actually from an honest perspective. But the question should be to anybody in a relationship or a friend. No, I don't think women, because all the things that over the years I heard comedians say, like, oh, women, you know, women are like this, women are like that. As a guy who was in a relationship, keep this, don't tell anybody this, with another guy, because I was, you know, living that lifestyle. We have all the same problems.
All right, that's interesting. By the way, does your wife Carol know?
Yep.
What do you say on stage?
Hold on, I just talked about this. So, but let me go a little long here. So, it's anybody in a relationship. That old joke was, oh, people, you know, gay people have it great because it's just two guys hanging out. Yeah, but when you're in a relationship with that other person, whether it's guy, girl, there's more of an investment. So it isn't any different. All the things that people say, oh, women do this and men do that. It's just, don't you think women in two women in a relationship deal with the same thing that a man and a woman deal with, or a woman and a man, or a man and a man? It's relationships. It's not, and I'm not saying women or men aren't different, but it's not as overdramatic as people say. People tend to be, there's secure people and there's insecure people. There's evolved people and there's unevolved people. There's depressed people. I don't think.
All right, let me,
men and women.
Okay, Todd, we're talking with Todd Glass and we're getting your questions on the internet.
Hold on 1 second. Shut the fuck up. No, I'm doing a podcast, Carol. You can't.
This marriage is doomed.
It's always something with you. It's always something, Carol. Ah, Jesus Christ. Sorry, I had to deal with something.
Your marriage is just... Okay.
Yeah. I don't want to do too many... Good, you go.
The stereotype of men who I hang out with, and that I want to move on, but I have a question. Is that women cannot admit they're wrong. That for them to admit they're wrong, it's like just total defeat. Have you heard that? Because I hear that a lot. Coming out of my mouth. I hear that a lot.
By the way.
I just seem to hear that.
I'm affectionately telling you this, David. I just told you I don't think that's right.
Okay. Now,
and by the way, if you want to hang around people that are fun to be around and evolved and caring, don't say shit that attracts people that have misconceived thoughts. And that feeds that type of thing. Oh, women do this. Men do this.
Uh-huh.
Oh, it's like at best, it's a bad premise for a comedy bit.
Yeah.
Men do this and women do that. That's why whenever you hear a comedian say, guys, can you do me a favor? I know the bit's going to suck. It's
right.
Like, all guys, hey, ladies, can you? Oh, why do I know brilliance isn't going to ensue after the setup?
And you're right about the laws of attraction. I always say if you keep making dirty jokes, all you're going to write are dirty jokes. And if you keep writing clean jokes in conversation, you make cleaner jokes.
You got to say, you know, who does your comedy feed? That's what I always say. And not that I haven't made mistakes and go back and look at my old work. I'm like, oh, fuck, I wish I could take that off the internet. But you got to ask yourself, and this is comedians or regular people, who does it draw? And you either feed, look, I'm saying this sloppily because if I'm so evolved, why would I call people stupid? But I'm going to lazily say it.
We call them retard Americans.
Yeah, that's the most evolved way you could say that. Who are you feeding? Who are you feeding? What comes out of your mouth? Do you feed intelligent people or do you feed stupid people? Because you can't lie. If you're a comedian and your audience is dumb, you can't not take responsibility for that. Or if you're just a regular person and all your friends, you're always going, all my friends are annoying and stupid. You don't think that has anything to do with you? Okay, next question. Oh, New Jersey. So my question to you is... if I would answer that as just, can some people admit they're wrong? Some people don't. There you go. It's that simple. So
now you're a comic who everybody loves, Todd Glass.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Because a lot of times you're right and the audience is wrong. And you give me the courage to do the things that I think are funny, but the audience may not enjoy. Say, you know, Jimmy Pardo was on last week and same thing with Jimmy. Would you say that you're willing to admit you're wrong comedically? When do you Because if the audience isn't laughing, sometimes you'll still do the bit. So when do you admit you're wrong comedically?
You know what? I will say this. I don't know why I started it that way. I don't think it's cute to bomb. And I don't want to bomb. I like doing well. And I think that will mean that when it happens, it's because I really think it's funny. I would never purposely do a bit because, oh, get it? Only the comedians are laughing in the back of the room. No, I don't like doing bad on stage, and you shouldn't. And I want the audience. And you might think, well, who the fuck wouldn't? You know what I mean? There's some people like, you know, no, I want to do well. But I've learned over the years that, and my podcast has certainly helped this because it's only you trusting your instincts, to, when it's not, to plow through it and do it for the people that are enjoying it. But but I don't think it's cute. I don't think it's like, oh, yeah, I'm bombing. No, I want to fucking, you know, I want to kill. I want to do great. And I don't want to blame the audience all the time. So I take responsibility a lot on stage, even in front of the audience. I'll even say it jokingly. I'll be, see that last thing I just did? I take responsibility for that. I'm not going to turn and go, oh, this crowd sucks. Right. Then 2 minutes later, when I'm mad at them, I go, nah, this one you got to fucking eat.
Right, right. I don't enjoy bombing. Right. I've just gotten used to it. Chet Melnick, that can't be a real name, writes in.
Sure it is.
Chet Melnick? That's a fake name. Todd, my wife is always afraid that somebody is ripping her off. She fights with cab drivers, bank tellers, etc., etc. How do I tell my wife to dial it back without her taking it as criticism?
Jeez, all your audience, your whole audience just complains about their wives.
Well, I do notice, I notice this. There are people, if you're in a, like, you ever, it doesn't have to be about a wife, but you ever see people who, like, give directions to cab drivers, like they know the best route, like Holly Hunter in Broadcast News, and they're so
most, but isn't that the old like five and dime therapy, figuring that out? Most people who think that everyone's ripping them off, isn't it probably a little true that it's because they're ripping everybody else off, so they think, why wouldn't anybody else act like them?
Yes, projection. You're projecting your evilness on others, right?
Yes. 365-4100 will take your calls. Ask Todd. He'll be right back with us. Hey, have you been to the new Cheesecake Factory at the Grove? I'll tell you what, they make all their own sauces. And they get there early in the morning to do it. The Grove and the Cheesecake Factory. I'll tell you what, anything you eat at that Cheesecake Factory, you're going to eat it, and you're going to go, how do they do it? The Cheesecake Factory, good for Christmas or any okay, that's it. I tried to do like an in-house read. But yeah, so I think I answered the New Jersey guy's question, maybe. Then this guy about his wife, she thinks everybody's ripping her off.
Mm-hmm. By the way, that five and dime reference. I love going to the five and dime because everything is either a nickel or a dime. It's so much cheaper than the 99-cent store, right?
Yeah, I gotta update that term. By the way, I don't think five and dimes were open when I was a kid. But, well, they probably were. They were probably on their way out at that time. But I should call it 99-cent store therapy.
Yes. By the way, I shop at the 98-cent store. Now, the service isn't as good as the 99-cent store, but you know, it's really worth the savings. It really is.
I hate my laugh. Let's go with another question. I'm very excited
Bob Hoffman.
I want to get one I really want to sink my teeth in.
Oh, this is interesting, and I think this is a gay question because it reads like this.
It's a
gay question because it reads like this. My boyfriend is constantly...
it's funny.
Okay.
Funny shit.
Thank you. My boyfriend is constantly talking to his boyfriends about his relationship with me. I feel that it is an invasion of our privacy because we go to parties and I have to see his friends. But he says we're only as sick as our secrets. Who's right? Who's wrong?
You know, I think I'm going to go out on a limb here and answer all these questions a little bit, clean them all up. Are you ready?
Yes.
And by the way, I don't give advice because I think I'm perfect. I've done a lot of mistakes in my life, but maybe in this area,
you're
I've
perfect.
Done a good thing.
You're perfect.
I, No. I know you're kidding, but I
you are. You're a good friend. You know what's important. You're a good friend. You are.
But like everybody else, I have my shit. I have my bad cycles I get into. I have bad habits. I'm not saying this, but in one area,
the people you murder, we're going to die anyway.
Deserve it.
Well, they were going to die anyway, eventually.
Thank you. Thank you. Play your jingle. We call that a podcast. Listen, so.
Well, I think this is kind of. This is an interesting question. And that
is. I'm going to answer it.
Oh, answer it.
I'm going to answer it. This is mostly all about communication. And listen, I know some people like sort of shit on therapy. And you don't. But I'll get to your answer. Just be patient with me here. Because I think they answer all this. I did in a relationship go to couples counseling. And it really helped. And I'm going to even echo the words of Dr. Phil. You might think, why it muddies this up, but I actually respect him. And
I go to him, by the way, Dr. Phil, I go to for all my weight loss and hair loss advice.
All right. You're done. Don't get in the way. when you go to counseling, it's not fake. It's all about communication. Now there's different counseling for different people, but I'm talking about couples counseling. If you go and you don't fight it, if you go wanting to change, you can make miraculous changes very quickly. Keep in mind, a lot of people go, they're fighting. And once you reap the benefits of getting on the other side, it's just like anything. Once you quit smoking, it does get easier because you see the other side of it. Once you get off drugs, it's hard getting off drugs because you're not reaping the benefits of having a clean head. But everyone that gets off drugs usually will tell you, oh, it does get easier once you reap the benefits of getting off the drug. And it's the same thing with couples counseling. Once you learn and you listen, you don't fight it, and you learn communication skills, and you learn it really does fucking make a difference. So all these questions are about communication. I guarantee you we're not hearing the other person's side of it. We're not hearing, we don't know if they're telling the right version of it. If the other person was in the room, they'd go, well, that's not what he does. He's saying in his question, all my wife does is this, or all my, we had the other person in the room, they might go, well, that's not what happened. So if you're having trouble in your relationship, if you don't be a good skier by wanting really fucking bad to be a good skier.
Well, but here's
the same thing.
You're not answering the question.
Yes, I am. My boyfriend says this, and then what was it? It was all like in this, but I guarantee it's all communication. Like they're asking a question, but I don't even know what advice. Repeat the question again, and I want to make sure I answer it correctly. Repeat the question again.
You talk about communications, but you're not listening to me. And I feel...
Well, because there's times not to listen. That's my next point.
It seems to me that in a relationship, there's one person who doesn't talk to his or her friends about the relationship, and there's another person in that relationship who's constantly going back to his or her friends and saying, this is where we are in our relationship, and we do this, and we did that, but he or she didn't do this, and then during the... Blah, 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 blah. Is that fair to say that in a typical...
Okay, I can answer that.
And that the person...
My mom does that sometimes.
Hang on for 1 second. Let me...
And I always tell her...
Hang on, let me ask my question. I'm asking this guy's question.
Okay.
Is it fair to say that in most relationships, there's one person who keeps everything bottled up inside, doesn't share what's going on in that relationship, and that there's the other person in the relationship is off talking to close friends about the relationship and getting advice, and the person who keeps everything bottled up inside doesn't appreciate that the partner going off and talking about the relationship. Is that typical of a relationship? I think it is.
I think it depends in the relationship where somebody is doing that. And by the way, I'm sure this person is not saying if it was done once in a while, they probably wouldn't be complaining. So I'm going to guess that the other person is constantly doing it. And of course that's dangerous because, my mom does that. When she's having trouble with her husband, she tells everybody. And then when they make up and they work it out, they go to every place knowing every little detail. And yeah, sometimes it is okay to share something with a friend. But other times, you don't have to. I mean, that's sort of a no-brainer. Yeah, you don't have to tell everybody every goddamn time there's an argument because, some things are... then they don't need to know it. Does that make sense?
Yes. Are we as sick as...
I don't think it's...
Are we as sick as our secrets?
Everybody's perception is their reality. And I know by talking to you on the phone, Dave, that your perception is major your reality. Because when you ask these questions, you don't realize that even if it's 25% of couples that are in healthy relationships, you know what I mean by healthy, you still argue, but you can be in a surprisingly good relationship. But when you ask the questions, you're like, isn't it true that all couples, you don't realize, oh, there's not all, just the ones that are,
oh, my God, it's Avi Lieberman.
Is that true?
Yeah. Hang on. How do I merge these?
No, please.
I know. All right.
He talks about his Jewish things. It kills me.
I want him to book Gilbert Gottfried in Israel. Has Gilbert played on?
Can I tell you something about Avi Lieberman, who obviously, like everybody, I love?
We love Avi.
When I went to Israel, I'm not a political comedian, but when I went to Israel and I saw that the women are on one side, can you hear me?
Yeah.
On the wailing, is it the wall? What's the wall?
The wailing wall.
And I saw women are on one side and men are on the other, and I went, oh, no wonder they have fucking problems. They can't get along with other countries. They can't even respect each other. Women go on this side and men go on the other. If a little kid did that, you go, stop it. But they get the women are over there and the men are over there. So I told Avi about that. And I said also, like in the synagogue, how the women in certain, I guess not in modern, but in the Orthodox synagogues, the women sit in the back or they wear the wigs. And he goes, oh, that's not because it's not equal. It's because the women will distract the rabbi because if they're beautiful. And I said, I have an idea. Tell the rabbi to put his dick in his pants and grow the fuck up and let the women sit wherever they want.
Exactly. And there's a very great comedian who we may or may not have mentioned in the show today, whose sister is a brilliant rabbi who I believe was stoned.
Sarah Silverman.
I'm not going to, her somebody's sister, I think, is a rabbi and had rocks thrown at her for trying to pray on the wrong side of the wall, right?
I didn't know that, but you know what? Good for them. It proves that my instincts were right. We can't get along with these people. You can't even respect yourself. Stop it already. It's not even that complicated. You know, some social issues, you got to go, stop it. Stop it already with this men and the women shit. Stop it. You made it up. Everybody's born equal. End of story. Anything after that you've created. So grow up. If I spanked, which I don't believe in spanking, I'd go over and I'd spank you and go, stop it. Stop it already, you fucking idiots.
Okay.
Women sit over there and men sit there. Fucking grow up and cut the shit. Yeah.
Am I right, ladies? End it with guns.
Am I right? Hello?
But here's something that in Hoffman's question here. He says, let me ask you, because I want to do a follow-up. Because I agree with him. He says, Bob Hoffman says, we're only as sick as our secrets. I agree with that we're only as sick as our secrets. Because I remember when Franklin Roosevelt finally leveled with everybody and said, I've got polio, folks. I've been keeping it secret, but I've got polio. And the minute he revealed that secret, he stood up and started walking.
Hey, by the way, who wouldn't agree with that? First of all, how embarrassing that the president of the United States, they didn't want everyone to know that he was in a wheelchair because it would make him look weak, as opposed to making him look like a superhero for every kid that maybe had that same, that had polio or whatever their situation was, to put them in a chair to go, fuck, you could be the president of the United States and be in a wheelchair. That's the society we lived in. Bunch of morons.
Right. So, but do you think we're only as sick as our secrets?
Of course. That's why sometimes when I'm on a podcast where they want you to talk about things that you might have kept a secret or you don't talk about, I always think it's healthy, and I always remind myself, why am I talking about this, Todd? Just because you like to hear yourself talk? Or is it important? And then now sometimes I just like to hear myself talk, but other times I think, of course. You know, people say, oh, back in the day, people didn't have all the problems they have now. Yes, they did. They just kept it bottled up and guilt, and drank all their problems away.
Yeah.
Everything was a secret then. I have a joke in my act about they wouldn't even say underwear. They called it unmentionables. What could have come good from a bunch of buffoons that were embarrassed to say underwear? But meanwhile, black people couldn't sit on the front of the bus. You think you really were fighting for the right cause, you dumb fucks?
In defense, I'm not saying Rosa Parks was wrong, but I'm saying it is a much smoother ride at the back of the bus. I'm just saying. Have you ever sat in the front of a bus? It's much more comfortable in the back. Again.
Thank you.
She should be able to sit anywhere she wants, but the back is a smoother ride. Well, speaking of alcoholism, AM writes in, I'm an alcoholic. My 15-year-old son is starting to drink a little. Should I tell him that I'm an alcoholic and that I'm worried that he carries my gene? Or, this is funny, or should I check with my wife to make sure he's really my son? I have funny listeners. You know what I like?
By the way,
I have smart listeners. You know how people try to be funny and you go, stop it. But I have, like, there's a guy named Nickname who tweets me. There's a joke he gave me that I actually use in my act. I don't know who Nickname is. I have very smart, clever listeners. That's a funny question, right?
That is, at the end of all that. Or should I not even bother?
Yeah. What do you tell a 15-year-old child who's
starting? You're not going to like my answer.
Okay.
There proves that I will sometimes shut up. I think that's a really good question, and I think if you went to the right person, you could answer that and implement a plan that would be crystal clear and the best way to deal with it. And I don't know what that is. I don't know what that is. Usually honesty leads to the best thing, and I'm sure it's based in being honest with your child, but I don't know the details of that. Whenever I have a question like that, I have a friend, Kevin. I call him almost Dr. Kevin because he have his license yet, but I've been loving him. He's a friend I've known since I was 18. He just recently he's going for his degree. And whenever I have a problem, it's amazing how quick he can untangle it for me. Doesn't mean I have to come into therapy every week, but I'll call him, I'll give him a call, and I'll be like, hey, I'm dealing with this situation. And he'll give me tangible advice that I can implement right away. And I think that's one of those questions.
I have a friend who has a degree, too, who helps. He's a black belt, and he just beats the shit out of people. What's he getting a degree in?
Child therapy.
Okay. Helping
therapy. But my point is that it's amazing how, like, it could be something big or little. I could be going home and maybe something's happened at Thanksgiving at my house. My mom wants to do this. My brothers want to do that. It's amazing when I call him, and if I shut up and listen, he'll tell me some things, and majority of the time I hang up going, wow, I would have never thought about that. I didn't think to start with my brother and not deal with my mom or call. I was like, wow, or pull back and not deal with it all. It's not my responsibility. But man, Kevin is a major help in my life.
What do you say to a 15-year-old kid who is having a drink or smoking a joint?
I don't know the answer to that.
Is it wrong? You do deal in black and white. You are one of the things I love.
No, there's a lot of gray areas in life. I don't know the answer to that. I don't know. I don't think they'd be smoking in front of you. Isn't the question if you found out they were smoking?
Well, Shakespeare says all life is all the world's a stage, right? You know, I think it's from Macbeth. But the thing is, we have roles to play in this world. So if you're an adult and you see a 15-year-old drinking alcohol or smoking dope, is your role, aren't you supposed to say, hey, you're too young to be drinking, right?
What do you mean? Oh, well, yeah, I guess in front of you, yes. But I thought you meant, oh, the child's drinking in front of him, or did he find out? Now, why would the kid smoke pot in front of his dad? That doesn't even make any sense.
Let me ask you a personal question.
Did you hear me? Did you hear what I said?
Yeah, I agree with you. It suggests to me that the parents probably drink and smoke dope, right?
There's some, yeah, most likely. I mean, even kids that aren't the brightest in the world usually inherently know to not drink and smoke in front of their parents. Now, if it's like in certain cultures where they do let the kids, you know, have some wine at a young age, I would implement the same rule. By the way, my mom did with pot. Like, you know, she let us smoke pot in front of her once when we were very young. And I admire her for it, because some people have found that with drinking, to let kids have a little bit of wine, I think pot is the same thing. But again, I'm not sure. So I love giving advice, but I'm sure I'd be a little off with how to deal with it.
I'll get to the next question in a second, but I have a question for you. I was at a party.
Sure.
I was at a party and a 21-year-old friend. It was like, you know, family friends that get together. Mm-hmm. And a 21-year-old friend of my daughter's walks up to me, and he's got a beer in his hand, and he's obviously just smoked a joint, and he's got a cigarette in his hand. And he's going, "Hey, how's it going, man? What are you up to, dude?" And he's talking to me like that. And I made small talk with him for, you know, 5 minutes. And then I went off into the corner and said to my wife, "Where the F does he get off talking to me that way?" And she goes, "What?" I go, "How dare a 21-year-old walk up to me with, you know, obviously stoned from pot, holding a beer and a cigarette, and talk?" And so that became like, "You're wrong." I was told, "You're wrong. He's 21. He can talk to." And I felt like saying to him, I didn't, but like, "F you. How dare you talk to me?"
Yeah, I got. Did this really happen?
Yes. Swear to God.
Yeah, I got to be honest. Like, hey, by the way, except for this, I mean, look, smoking obviously is not good for you. So let's move past that. So I would be happy that a 20-year-old wanted to come up and talk to me. I like having all, and by the way, 70-year-olds can be fucking stupid too. So we're talking about.
But I'm supposed to be.
Anybody you're talking to, you'd like to be interesting, articulate, aware of, you know, the surroundings. So let's just say it's advice for anybody.
He went to elementary school. He went to elementary school with one of my kids. So I've known him since he was a kid. And I'm supposed to be cool with him being stone drunk and smoking.
Is he interesting? Did he say anything interesting? Was he enjoyable to talk to?
I couldn't get past the fact that he was stone drunk and smoking a cigarette.
No, I think, hey, by the way, you should do whatever works for you. This is not, and believe me, I'm not just saying that to be passive aggressive, but if it was me, if somebody's interesting, hey, I hang out with comedians that are sometimes 18 years old, newer comedians, granted that not all, but some are 18, some are 19, a lot are 21, 22 when you go on the road. And if they're interesting, they might not be where I'm at on stage yet, but off stage, comedian's a comedian. You're hanging out with a 3-year comedian or a. So,
all right.
I like being around all ages.
All right.
I don't want to get to the point in my life where I'm not hanging out with every age. So I'm all right with that. I think your wife was right, to be honest.
Okay. But the other thing, and this is true, he called me David instead of Dr. Feldman because I've always told him I was, seriously, he's always thought I was an ophthalmologist. I lie to a lot of my kids' friends because I didn't want them to know I was a comedian. Yeah, no, seriously. So I was always Dr. Feldman around him. And I think I deserve the respect that I should receive had I gone to 8 years of medical school and done the internship. And to call me David instead of Dr. Feldman, the fact that I'm not really an ophthalmologist, he doesn't know that I'm not an ophthalmologist.
Okay, can I tell you, I got an email here from somebody. It says, "Dear Todd, my friend's parents lie, his dad, and says that he's an ophthalmologist. Do I need to fucking go to my death with this? Or can I just walk up to him at the next party, even if it takes me getting drunk, lighting a cigarette and smoking pot, and call him by his real fucking name like I know he is?" So this, I think, might be the person in your email, only hitting me from another angle, actually.
Yes. But, okay, there's an old episode. But, that's I was making a joke. But people who listen to this show know of my history of...
David, I got to interject. I'm really surprised at you. I'm being totally genuine that, like... And again, if an 80-year-old came up and had a cigarette and it was blowing in my face, and no, of course, but it's not age related.
No, yes, it is. Yes, it is. When an 80-year old, excuse me for 1 second, Todd. If an 80-year-old walks up to me blowing smoke in my face, it kills the stench of the shit in their pants.
David.
Because 80-year-olds, every 80-year-old shits themselves and they all stink. Hello? I rather smell cigarette smoke than 80-year-old poo.
Hey, let me tell you something. I stopped saying an age that was 30 years past mine. When I was 20, I thought 50-year-olds did shit. When you're 80, you know what's going to happen when you're 80? You're going to go, "Wow, I still feel like I'm 20," at least in your head and your heart. So,
Does it bother you? Because it really bothers me that I'm not even like 1/100th as funny as James Adomian. Do you ever? I mean, you're very funny. But is James Adomian the funniest man in the world?
Well, I mean, I think there's a slew of those guys that are like that for me. Like I said, but you know, Eddie Pepitone, Brian Regan, James Adomian, that just Andy Kindler. It certainly makes me, when I see them, work harder. It makes me, because it all comes into, I think they tap into their core of what makes them funny. I don't think they thought it out, obviously, but if you're going to be analytical about it, so it makes you go, just whatever makes you funny, tap into it, or you're not going to be doing what they're doing.
Do you get jealous?
Oh, of course I do. I get fucking get jealous. But like I said, it just, you know, it just reminds me to, again, it doesn't remind me, oh, you should write more, or you should. No. It reminds me, make sure you're tapping in, because that's what those guys have done. They tap into their guts. Kindler, Pepitone, you know, all those guys.
Okay.
Jen Kirkman, I feel, does that, you know.
Do you love watching comedy? I was watching Jeselnik's special the other night. You know, Jeselnik is absolutely hysterical. For some reason, I just avoided watching him. I don't know why, just because I think we look alike. And
I love Anthony, but I haven't seen the special. But the funny thing is, I'm watching it tonight with some friends because they're like, I want to watch that special too. I love watching comedy. I do. I still love it. Whenever I meet a comedian, sometimes on the road, I don't like watching comedy anymore. Well, maybe you're watching the wrong comedy, because like I was just in Atlanta and I went around a few of the one-nighter shows. You know, I got in town two nights early. It's wow. It's amazing. Like, there's a lot of funny new comedians. Yes. Yeah, I love watching comedy. Hey, there's times when I'll...
You know what I love about Jeselnik? He does nothing to make you like him. It's like you have to accept him completely on his terms, and he's not asking to be liked. It's great.
Yeah, of course he wants to be liked, but I know what you mean. Like, you're not on stage. Anthony just did my podcast a few weeks ago, and you know what I like about Anthony? He also has a very silly side. Like, he has that other side of him. But also on the podcast, if you listen to it, he totally did like silly bits and went along with bits, and you know, took him down the same path I like to take him, and did great at it. You know,
Maybe one day I'll do your podcast. Anyway, here's a question.
Yes,
Todd Glass. No, something man. I can't even read the name here. My boyfriend is always late. He makes all the money in the relationship. And says that's the cause for his late. I can't read this. And says that's the cause for his lateness is from being tied up at work. My boyfriend is always late. He makes all the money in the relationship and says he's apparently late because he's working. Should I be more sympathetic to his being late, or is it a power trip? So I guess the question is, the boyfriend makes all the money, so when he's late, he says, "Hey, I'm working. I'm entitled to be late." Is that a
Can I tell you something? Yeah, I'm going to answer this question. And look, we'll never run out of stuff to talk about. I'm being totally honest with you. It's echoing something I said a second ago. And it's not the premise of your whole show. So if I don't answer these questions, we can go down another path. We'll have enough to talk about. I hate these questions, and I'll tell you why. Because if you're giving shit advice, sometimes a question can be good. You get an email, you can really... But all these questions have to do with tone and how late this person is. So I feel like I don't want to give half-baked, shitty advice.
You're chickening out here, and you do give good advice.
I'm not.
Yes,
no,
you
I'm
are.
Not.
You're chickening
no,
out.
No, I'm not.
You and I are in a relationship. Don't back away from this. Because this was, by the way, a television show that we pitched that never got sold. So let's commit.
Yeah, because I would... Hold on. Because there's too many... Look, David, you have people that listen to your show. There's going to be people now, and I like to say this, and then we'll move forward, that are going to go, Todd's right. And there's going to be people that like go, David's right. No, answer the question. That's what you're doing. You're doing a little thing, and you're answering some questions. But there's too many levels and things.
All right,
I
think this is a good question. My listeners took the time to write these questions, and they deserve to...
I'm not making fun of your listener for writing the question. Hold on, let me make that really clear. I'm not I'm not giving them, I'm not making fun of them for writing a question, knowing all the specifics of it and be able to ask five questions to her and five questions to him and how often this happens. And because there's going to be legitimate times without being sexist, because it could be two guys in a relationship and one's the breadwinner. But so you don't know if it's a power trip unless you ask 15 questions.
I'm going to ask you this question. I see what this person is asking. Is lateness a power thing? Is that fair to say to
someone?
Fair? Hang on for 1 second, Todd Glass, before you interrupt me. You and I are in a relationship, okay? You make all the money. I'm at your mercy financially, okay? You're always late, and you use the fact that you're working and making all this money as an excuse for your lateness. And I'm asking you, as the person who doesn't make as much money as you, to be a little more sympathetic to me and not say that, because...
Okay.
I think it's wrong for... I'm going to give you an answer. I think it's wrong.
No.
Go ahead.
I'm going to answer.
And this is why they didn't buy our show, because you're not. I'm kidding. But this would have been a good show.
That's not true at all. I would do it right if I had a show. I don't like to send people that have problems back to their relationship causing more. But I will answer your question. But I'm going to answer it indirectly. So let me just, I talk long. But if you had this person and both people in the room, you could establish some things like, are they late when it comes to going out to dinner on the weekend when it has nothing to do with work? Obviously, in isolated situations, if work is the type of work where they call you last minute and they ask you to do things and you're running late, you would hope the person would be sympathetic to that. But if you had both parties in the room, you could instantly establish, how are they when they're going out to dinner on the weekend? How are they when they're planning on meeting up friends for movies? So if the person said, yeah, they're late always, well, then you find out instantly it doesn't always have to do with their work. And then you can address it properly. So let's make pretend it doesn't have to do with their work. Most people that are late, I used to be late all the time. I got out of that habit. You have to get something out of it. Now, I don't know what it is, but no one
That's
is
great.
Late all the time. People don't tend to do things that don't service them well. And it is inconsiderate, I have disdain for it.
Remember Joan Cusack in Broadcast News when she's like dodging drawers, trying to get that tape delivered to playback in Broadcast News?
I don't, but go ahead.
I'm late because I get off on the thrill of not being late. You know what I'm saying? I've talked about this with my shrink. So what? And I'm trying to correct being late. And one of the reasons I'm late, it's not a power thing. I like to squeeze as much into the day as I possibly can. But I also, and that's why I'm late. But I also get off on the thrill of not being late. You know what I'm saying?
Do you want me to answer that honestly?
Yeah.
If you saw the direct, like if you hit your hand with a hammer, you instantly see the pain that causes.
Right.
If you hit your hand with a hammer and that pain sometimes happens a day later, a week later, indirectly, you might keep hitting your hand with the hammer. But because you instantly see the pain that causes, you stop that behavior. And if you saw the ramifications that happened because of that stupid fucking thing you like to do by showing up late, you'd cut it out because it's not servicing you well in the big picture.
What if I like to establish dominance by being late? In other words, you wait for me. I don't wait for you.
Well, if it services you right, and you seem to be liking your life, keep doing it. Yeah, what do you think? I'm going to argue with you on the phone like a fucking idiot? Do it. If it treats you right and you're meeting the people you like and you're getting into relationships and you seem to be happy and you're getting along with your kids or you're getting along with everybody and it seems to service you right, why? I wouldn't fucking stop it in a heartbeat.
Okay,
so just keep doing it if it's treating you right.
We're talking with Todd Glass, and I want to ask you about rooming with Michael Komen and Mr. Rosenthal and all that.
Oh, yeah.
But because people wrote these questions, I want to get to them. So give me quick answers to this. I was walking down the street the other day, and I noticed a female walking by blatantly checking me out. When I caught her eye, I panicked and looked away. What is the proper etiquette when someone of the opposite sex or same sex makes eye contact with me. I'm in New York City, and that's interesting. Like when people make eye contact with you on the street, what is the etiquette? Because I'm always
I pull my pants down and jerk off.
Okay.
No, that's a good one because I'm really bad at that because I get so nervous. I don't do. I'm always nervous. I thought about writing something on a card that says, "Hey, I'm really shitty at this," but you know, I don't. And then you can just hand it to him and leave and go. I don't like to make people uncomfortable.
But would you mind if leave. I jerked off to you?
I don't even want to masturbate to you unless I have your permission.
That's actually Michael Komen. That is actually a Michael Komen. We'll get to Michael Komen in a second.
So I don't know if that was a good, but you could do that. Write something down and then you give it to the person. Handwrite it. Don't print it out in masses. It looks scary.
Yeah, yeah.
But handwrite it ahead of time. Go, hey, I just made eye contact with you, and you walk over. Hey, I'm going to give you this, and get out of your way. That way I don't make you uncomfortable. You could be married. I don't know. Hear it and walk away. I don't know. Something like that might be a good idea.
We're going to get to Michael Komen in a second. Michael Komen had an idea of where somebody was asking for permission. The guy is such a rube that he has to ask women for permission to masturbate to them.
He's such a what? He's a prude?
Komen had an idea where a character who is a rube thinks proper etiquette is to ask a woman for permission to masturbate.
Do you mind if I... That's a good way of telling someone you're attracted to them and you're not even asking to date them. You just act like you have such high etiquette that you're just saying, oh, I don't want to date you, I don't make you uncomfortable, but, you know, the way I am is I don't want to even masturbate to you unless I would have your permission. So is that okay with you? If it's not, I won't do it.
Okay, so I have two more questions, and then I want to ask you about your roommate situation, because I do believe... because I believe that people living together shape one another. Like, there's a famous apartment in San Francisco where all these comics lived, and I think you, Rosenthal, and Komen living together kind of was, as Alex would say, a movement. My ex-wife is about to get married. She's invited me to the wedding. I don't have a date. How do I show up stag to the wedding? Any acting tips on how to pretend to be happy for them?
Well, you could try. Obviously, they have some amicability, if that's the right word, if she's inviting him. So who can't get someone to go to a wedding? It would make it a lot more comfortable.
Who wants to go to a wedding? What, really? You think it's easy to get a date to go to a wedding?
To go, if you have a friend that's going as a friend, you go, look, I want to go to my ex's wedding, maybe for the kids. Who knows what the intricacies of this, why it would be okay to show up. They're obviously not hating each other. We know that for a fact, or he wouldn't be invited to the wedding.
Can you be happy for an ex?
Yeah, I was in a relationship for 13 years, and it's funny you ask that, because I just talked to him the other day and said, listen, this is going to be really hard to talk about, but eventually we're going to meet somebody that we care about, and if we are not comfortable enough to introduce them to each other, we can't go on to be as close as we are. So we decided when that comes time, when we meet somebody that we care enough about where, you know, that we'll even go to a couples counseling or two just to figure out the best way to do this.
Wow. But,
yeah. Matter of fact, I said I think he has it easier because – but by the way, I do know people in my life that were in relationships and they don't hardly talk at all to – yeah, they get along pretty good to get along crazy good. My friend Jordan – and he doesn't hate his ex-wife. You know, there's certain situations where someone might have had a drinking problem and you have to distance yourself. But in this case, it just ran its course. He's friends with his ex-wife's new husband. And it's not one in a million. It's not the norm, but it does happen. And I want people to meet. Here's how I would be happy. If people met the three of us and they went, wait, you and Todd used to go out? How's your new... I think it can be that. It takes a little work, but I'm willing to make it. Most people don't work hard unless they have the reward. And to me, the reward is, are you there?
Yeah, I'm listening, hanging on everybody.
If he meets somebody and I get along with them, that I get to have him in my life forever. And that's a great reward for me. So I'm willing to work at it. I might have a stomach ache when I see him with somebody else, but I'll get over it. I'll do whatever it takes.
Is life easier now that gay marriage is legal? I think it is.
Well, it didn't...
Don't you?
Well, it sounds funny to answer that question. I mean, directly, it hasn't really affected me, but it affects me the same as whenever any group of people is given the rights they deserve. You're just happy that the planet is moving forward in a positive direction. So whether it's women's rights or social issues or racial issues, you know, it's life's easier when people are all treated fairly.
Yeah. Are you a little happier because the Supreme Court ruled? I think people are, not just gay couples. I just think people are happier.
Well, I think anybody that, you know, has a clear head, yeah, you're happier when people are being treated. We still have a shit ton to do, but yeah, I think most what I call evolved people, fair, evolved, kind, decent, are always happier when we watch a group of people that had to fight to get rights get them. And like I said, I don't think it's just gay rights. It's any person on the planet's rights.
Right, right.
That's why I try not to turn around and do it to the next group. You know, those people that say, I'm all right with gay marriage, but now I got to be all right with the transgender. Yeah, what the fuck do you give a shit? What, are you done evolving? Why are you so worried? Hey, I grew in this area. Should I just keep growing every year? Yeah.
Well,
what's next?
I will say
you
this.
You know those people?
I will say Go this. Ahead. When they legalized gay marriage, my marriage fell apart. So maybe...
Good. Good.
I'm joking. Okay.
I know you are.
Before we go, I'm fascinated by your roommate situation. You lived with... Michael Komen created Nathan for You, which is the funniest show on television right now. Have you seen Nathan for You?
I went to the premiere, but I have not seen it since.
Funniest show on television. About it. Go watch Nathan for You. It's the funniest show on television. Michael Komen, brilliant guy. He's married. And if all I said was that he's the husband of Kimmy Schmidt, he'd be proud that he's married to the star of Kimmy Schmidt. And he's very proud of her. That's a Tracy Hepburn movie waiting to be destroyed by Hollywood, his marriage. Right. So Rosenthal, who is just a genius, and we had him on the show, actually. He's an editor, a musician. So what was your living situation with Komen and Rosenthal? And there was somebody else involved, right?
Yeah, there was. When I was probably 32 at the time, and I met Mike at a comedy club, and we started talking. You know how it is. We just got along great. And Mike was probably 19 at the time.
Michael Komen.
And I thought he was like 23 or 24. Like, he just seemed a lot older. And we got along, and we started, you know, getting along. And he had a friend, Steve Rosenthal, and Steve was friends with Avi Lieberman. And so Mike had another college friend. Mike went to USC at the time, and he had a friend, James Milton, who wasn't even in the business. And about 3 months after that, when we met, I needed a place to live. I wanted to move, and we found this really cool house up in Canyon. It was like a 6-bedroom, 4 baths. We all had our own little areas, and we ended up moving in together. Me, Mike, James, and then eventually Steve Rosenthal. All the four of us lived in this house, and it was really nice house. Like, we made it so cool, and we got a lot done. Those guys, like, I knew right away, like, that Mike was talented.
Michael Komen. Michael Komen.
Yes. And Steve, too. And I knew that they were going to be successful. Like, I knew it. I don't just say that about everybody. Some people are successful that I didn't predict it. I'm happy for them, but I didn't predict it. And with those guys, I knew it. I knew that. And that's the first time when I came home from an audition, and I told Mike and Steve that I hated auditions. They made me nervous. I wish I could just have a show where I was in a coma. And Mike said it. He goes, oh, no, I said it sarcastically, but Mike, the one who said, we should do that. And about a week later, we started putting the show together, and we sent out emails to people, and we set up an account, and we shot it on our own, all because of Steve and Mike. They edited, they wrote, we auditioned people, we put it up as a play, sort of, in the Comedy Central workspace.
Todd's Coma.
Yeah, Todd's Coma. where the basic premise was for your listeners that I'm in a coma. People come by to visit me and they tell stories about me. So if it's the Rolling Stones, they're like, oh yeah, Todd used to be our drummer, but he had a real bad temper. Or if it's Sarah Silverman, oh, I went on a date with Todd. So the show was life in the hospital, obviously, because there's always a lot of people hanging out and visiting. And then it's life when you find out about my past only through people telling stories about me. That was 15 years ago.
This was 15 years ago. And so Michael Komen was still at USC or UCLA.
He was, or right afterwards, okay. Right afterwards. Maybe he had graduated, and we put it together and we got like amazing people to be in it because of, you know, really their follow throughness. Like we got Ben Stiller to be in it. We got Sarah Silverman was in it. Ray Romano was in it. Herb Albert was in it. Ariana Huffington was in it. So there were just a great cast of people. Jimmy Pardo played my best friend in the hospital. And, you know, we
so
put it all together.
So this was originally, so we're talking about the year 2000.
You know what? This might have been, when did, you could do a search on it. I remember Ben Stiller had just done Something About Mary. Was that the name of that movie, or Truth About,
so, yeah,
Truth About Mary?
That would be like 99, 98, 97.
So this was probably a year after that.
Okay. And it was mostly a stage show that... Then you
no, we wanted to have it as a sitcom or whatever you would call it.
But you started it as you started it as a stage show.
Well, we just did a one-time viewing. We actually did three shows in one day at the Comedy Central workspace. We did three showings of it in one day.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it. And then we thought from that we'll try to sell it.
And did Rosenthal edit it? Was he playing was he playing the piano at the Comedy Store at the time?
Yeah, Rosenthal was playing the piano. He was a stand-up comedian, mm-hmm. but he also was editing back when people first started editing on their computer. So he edited the entire pilot, which is available online. But there's that funny story about Rosenthal. I love it. And it's sort of making fun of bad premises. So he was at the piano. I love this story, Rosenthal. And there was a comedian on stage. He wasn't aware that his mic was hot. So the comedian's on stage going, why every time there's a cat stuck in a tree, why do they call the fire department? What are they going to afraid? The cat's going to self-combust? And Steve Rosenthal just says to himself, which ends up going through the whole house, he goes, for the fucking ladders. the ladders. He just goes, the ladders. Just picture hearing that right after the comedian says that joke and you hear someone go, for the ladders.
Mm-hmm. This was a bit that this was a bit that he used to do at the Comedy Store.
No, it wasn't a bit. It was the bit the comedian did. Steve Rosenthal was just on the piano because he would play on and off the comedians.
Yeah.
So the mic was for some reason hot or whatever the details were. He did not mean it to be heard through the whole house. But right. He just goes, for the ladders. Right. You know, sort of making fun of the comedian for the shitty premise.
So Adam Sandler picked up.
Well, what happened was we couldn't sell it. And I said, you know what? I'm done. I want to move on. Unless somebody, I used to say Jim Carrey, saw it and wanted to produce it. But I'm done pitching it.
Right.
So we let it lie for about a year and a half. And when people asked me, whatever happened with Todd's Comb? I would tell them the same thing. I go, you know, unless someone came along that was big enough to have to put it through, I'm sort of going to move on to other things. And then Adam Sandler called me one day, and I knew Adam, but we hadn't talked in a while. And he goes, hey, I'm in here with Nick Schwartzen. And what happened was they saw the DVD in there of the show, and Nick goes, oh, you should watch this. Adam watched it, called me, and said, let's do this. And we did it.
Wow.
We shot a pilot.
Wow.
We didn't end up selling it, but still, we did a big budget pilot.
Wow.
And Ben did it again. He redid a scene for me, which was, I mean, I don't know Ben Stiller that well, but it might have been one of the kindest things that anybody ever did for me that didn't know me that well, just to help me bring something that I had in my head to fruition.
And did Komen run the show?
Komen did not run it at that point because he was already too busy, but Tom Martin came in and was the showrunner, and Steve worked on the show. They, in all fairness, like Happy Madison hired every single person that did the original. You know, well, Mike was on board. Steve was on board. They let everybody that did the original pilot be part of the new show.
How long did you live with Komen and Rosenthal?
For 4 years.
Really?
And we got along great. It was pure joy.
I want to mention this because there are famous apartments and famous living situations. You know, Conan and Smigel and Jeff Garlin all live together in Chicago. There's a famous apartment in San Francisco. You know, apparently Garlin and Conan used to do this talk show in their living room, and Garlin would be George Takei, and all Conan would do would ask him about the residuals from Star Trek. Do you know about this?
I love it.
And there was, you know, they would just do a talk show with for themselves, like, you know, just to kill time. So it was 4 years with you, Komen, and Rosenthal. So that's like a movement. Mm-hmm. That's a comedy movement that's being hatched, right? You're living your lives, but you're moving in and out, but you're talking comedy, right? That was Komen.
We had the best time, and we had a really cool house, and we had a backyard, and like I'm pretty good at that stuff. I made it really nice, and those guys respected it, and you know, not that this is important, but it was such a big house. We literally all had our own areas. We all had our own bathroom. We all had a bedroom and a second room. Mm-hmm. One thing, you know, you were saying before we started the podcast, like, did that rub off on me? And it did. You know, when I see most successful people, you know, you can know the business of comedy, but not be funny. But those guys did both. And they worked. They fucking worked. You know, Mike Komen, you know, he had funny in his bones, I thought.
Yeah.
So did Steve.
Yeah.
But they also worked at it. And we used to say this. On a scale from 1 to 10, let's say there's two scales. One, how funny you are, just in your bones. Let's say you have a 10 at that. You're funny in your bones. You're just, you know, I'm saying it about them. And then there's the business end of it. 1 to 10, 10 being the best. You know how to work. You know how to write. You know how to put aside. Let's say even if you're a 5 at it, you'll probably do pretty good. And those guys were way past 5s. Like, they taught me, like, I never work as hard as they do still, but it set the standard higher for me. Like, they woke up, they did shit. When we were going to work, they showed up on time. They got their stuff done, and they were amazing. And they were like 19 and maybe 20, 23.
Wow.
No, they were like, Mike was 22.
Yeah. Yeah.
At that point, or 21.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't want to, I just can't. Did you keep up with Komen?
I do, yeah. You know, you go a little while without talking, but yeah, we keep up, and you know how that is with old friends. Like, me, Mike, and Steve just went out in New York, and, you know, it takes a half of a second, and you're doing the same bits, and you're giggling.
I can't. We have to wrap it up. I cannot imagine you and Michael Komen being friends.
We were great.
I would love to go out to dinner because I would love to see the dynamics, because you're complete opposite. I mean, I cannot imagine. And with Rosenthal in the mix, it would just be really funny and fun to watch the dynamic because I can't imagine it.
Yeah, maybe I take it for granted, but like, our dynamic is, it really is like magical. Like, I just thoroughly enjoy hanging out with those guys. They're just, you know, it's just, it feeds. You know why? I like, now the first part doesn't seem so great, but I do like crass, and I do like vulgarity, you know, like that comedy like that. But I also like sensitivity and guys that are comfortable in their skin. And I like that they feed all parts of my soul, the crassness, and then they're silly and they're sensitive and they're caring and they're kind and they're gentle and they're harsh. So for me, it's the whole package. And I think that's why I really adore, them or anybody like them.
Okay, I'm going to ask you, we're going to wrap it up. I have one personal question to ask about Michael Komen. Okay?
Yeah, he doesn't trim his toenails, but I yelled at him and he started.
Okay, that's all I needed to know. No, this is, and I don't care. Okay, so this is what I've noticed, because I worked with him in Smigel, and Smigel is a great impressionist, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just, you know. So I would never do an impression around Robert Smigel. I cram up. I just cannot do an impression around Smigel. I just don't. I've tried, and I freeze, and I just know better. Komen does impressions around Smigel, and he works on impressions. But he does it very quietly around Smigel. And my question to you, Todd Glass, is when you're living with Michael Coman, because he does these great, does he do loud impression? Have you seen him be boisterous in his impressions?
I don't think I ever saw Mike Coman do one impersonation.
Really?
No. Who does he do?
Well, he does this great imitation of a young college kid pretending to love his roommate named Todd Glass. That was a good impression.
Oh. No, seriously. What?
Oh, he does everybody. He does everybody. I've only seen him do it around Smigel. He does it kind of. He whispers the impressions, and I was wondering if, you know, when you're in a living room with him at his home, is he louder and, you know?
No, it's funny. I feel bad. I feel like I'm giving a shitty answer, but I never remember him doing impersonations. You know, all we would really do back then. I just started smoking pot, so we would come home. Wherever we were at, we'd all know that if we went home, we would be able to hang out with each other, and we would get high and just do bits until we couldn't breathe anymore.
Okay. Well, Todd Glass is just a great friend, and I love you, and I'm proud of you. And the name of your book that you wrote 2 years ago is?
The Todd Glass Situation.
Right. And
can I tell you the name? Do you have one more second?
Yeah, yeah. I wish we could go longer.
The name I wanted the book to be, Simon and Schuster, honestly, were awesome. But I love to, why do I tell this story? I've told it a few other times before, and I guess because to this day, I still wonder if I should have named the book what I wanted to name it. So I'm going to tell you what the name of the book was. And honestly, tell me if you could, I think the reader of it would have figured out what it was about because of the subtitle. Because of the subtitle. So here was the name of the book, which is a true story.
Mm-hmm.
All I ever wanted to meet was a nice girl with a terminal disease and other stupid things I said to keep the closet door shut.
Wow.
Because do you get what?
Yeah.
You guess? If
yeah.
not, I'll tell. But either way, if people can either guess, oh, maybe. So I had a plan when I was maybe 21. I met my the first person that I could ever talk about, you know, being gay. And our plan was, now look, it wasn't thought out. We were, you know, we were young kids, that we would meet a girl with cancer. And then when she died, we would just tell everybody forever, I never got over, you know, I never got over Karen. So they were afraid to name it that. So even I thought dumbed it down a little. Instead of all I ever wanted to do was meet a nice girl with cancer and other stupid things I said and did to keep the closet door shut, to all I ever wanted to do was meet a nice girl with a terminal disease. We thought maybe they'd go, you know what? It's the same thing, but we're okay with it. And they weren't. They didn't say no, but they were so kind about everything else and let me tell my story 100%. They didn't edit a word out of that thing. They were amazing that I thought maybe I owed them that they knew something that I didn't. But I'll never know.
What about pitching that as a movie, though?
Well, yeah, but, you know, I'm not good at that.
But that is a pretty funny idea for a movie, the guy who thinks he can solve his...
Oh, right, that element of it. You're right. I didn't even think about that, the specificness of, you know, where would... First of all, one of the people said, well, what would you do when she died? I go... Where would you meet her? I go, I didn't think this through. I was 21.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, you know, I mentioned this on the Jimmy Pardo show, and we do have to wrap it up because comedy and everything else is up next.
Coming up next.
Yeah. Before we should. Do you do that on your podcast?
I do. I say, I always say that our lead, we got a new time slot. We're following Marin now.
Oh, that's genius. Too bad I'm not on your show.
Yeah, sometimes I'll take a break. I'll wait, coming up on Mark Maron. Mark sits down with the President of the United States.
So my wife and I at Disneyland, I mentioned this, we see an epidemic of morbidly obese women with effeminate men. And is that a fair statement? Do you think that, kind of like how you were thinking of marrying a terminally ill woman, that there are closeted gay men from the Midwest who gravitate to morbidly obese women or try to fatten up their wives so they have an excuse for not having sex with them?
Look, the only way I can answer that question intelligently, because I think what happens maybe is you go after a woman, especially when the guy is very good looking, maybe that you're comfortable with, and you think, I think there might be something there why that was a safe haven. At least they felt that way. But I don't know exactly why, and I don't want to answer that ignorantly. But I think there might have been something there. I think it's just anybody out of your, you know, look, you people can fall in love and look past looks. We get that. So you don't want to sound so vain to go, oh, if you ever see a drop-dead gorgeous guy and then the woman isn't, that has to be a cover-up. Because there are situations where it's abso-fucking-lutely not. You just fell in love with somebody, and because you are maybe, you know, in touch with yourself, you look past looks. But yes, there probably is other situations where that does exist.
Great.
Did I answer you?
Yes, you did. Todd Glass, thank you so much for joining us.
God bless you. God bless your family. And I say that the God bless part I say sarcastically, but I do love you.
I love you too. Todd Glass, thank you so much for joining us.
Okay. Are we done, by the way? Can I say something? Did you stop recording is what I'm asking?
We stopped recording.
You stopped recording?
Yeah, we're done. It went okay. It wasn't great.
What the fuck was that, David?
What do you mean, what
those
the fuck?
Those shit questions.
Why don't you acting like you're doing me a goddamn fucking favor, you cunt?
David. I did that interview, tried to do the best I can. Are you fucking shitting
oh,
me?
Oh, if I were... If I were Adam Sandler, you would have brought your A game. Fuck you.
What if that was the minute we get off? The minute we're done the podcast, that's when our friendship turns into. Go fuck yourself. Those shit questions. You end the interview. Why would a morbidly obese woman? How about a morbidly obese guy, you sexist pile of shit? All right, Dave.
All right.
All right, I'll talk to you later.
That's our show. Thank you for listening. Our executive producer is Alex Brazell. Just want to remind you that we have premium content. As always, each week we're putting up premium content, premium episodes. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. It's $2.50 for each episode of premium content. Or for $5 a month, you can get the whole shebang for free. $5 a month. And you're helping to pay the bills here. Don't forget to shop on Amazon via the David Feldman Show website. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, join our mailing list, and I love meeting my listeners. I really do. We're doing a live taping of the David Feldman Show November 10th at 7 p.m. at QED in Astoria, Queens. It's going to star Jackie the Joke Man Martling, Esther Koo. She's an hysterical comedian who starred on the Jack and Triumph Show and Adult Swim, plus the brilliantly funny Frank Conniff. We're going to do a live taping of this show. Conversations, some performances. I don't know what we're going to do, but it's going to be great. And if you hit the contact button at davidfeldmanshow.com and say, hey, please put me on the guest list for your live taping, it's just that easy, you will be on the guest list. You got to give us your name and your email address so we can confirm that you're coming. If you live in Astoria, if you live in Manhattan, if you live in the tri-state area, or you know somebody who lives near Astoria, Queens, and you think they might enjoy a live taping of this show, hit the contact button, put them on the guest list. I want to meet my listeners. We're going to be doing a lot of live shows coming up in Boston and Ithaca, New York, and Washington, D.C., and Los Angeles. Even if you don't want to attend the show, hit the contact button anyway. It's working. It hasn't been working. We didn't know this. But our contact button is working now. So if you just want to contact me and email me and go back and forth, I answer all my emails. I didn't understand why I wasn't getting my emails, and then I found out the contact button wasn't working. But now it's working. Okay, from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.